Good morning.
Good morning.
What a wonderful day. So much to be thankful for on this day.
Amen.
We get to be in the Lord's house and to worship together and to see the number of us meeting together. What a celebration. Today, for the first time in a year, I got to eat in the social hall. What a celebration. The only bad thing was they had the table set up. I only got to sit by Brenda. But I'm telling you, we were there, and it had been a year. Awesome. Would you all please stand for the call to worship? Praise God in this holy house of worship and under the open skies.
Praise God for acts of power and for magnificent greatness.
Praise with a blast on the trumpet. Praise by strumming soft strings.
Praise God with dance and song.
Let every living, breathing creature praise God.
Christ our Lord is risen today.
Hallelujah!
And now please bow. Heavenly Father, we come to you today celebrating a very special day. We celebrate the empty tomb. So simple, yet so hard for so many to comprehend the meaning. We just ask and pray that people can see the impact of this world event. In your name we pray, amen. Please remain standing for the praise song.
Good morning, everyone. He is risen.
He's risen indeed.
Oh, let's try that again. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
There you go. That's how you're supposed to sound. We're going to start this day with two of the most beautiful and traditional Easter songs we could possibly sing. Both of them are in the hymnal for those of you who like to use hymnals, but the words will be up here, starting with Christ the Lord is risen today.
Jesus, my Lord.
The next hymn will be, which one, four? Oh, 220. So this is going to be He Lives.
Covered by the mantle of dying, for those hemmed in by illness, visible or veiled, hear our cry for help. For those weighed down with worries, for those carrying the burdens of distress, for those overwhelmed by isolation, hear our cry for help. For those who are weary, for those who are tattered and worn, for those who collapse from exhaustion, hear our cry for help. Risen Lord, hear our cry of thanksgiving for the graciousness with which you hear, for the patience with which you listen, for the grace with which you care. Hear our cry of thanksgiving for the ways you accompany us through life's deepest, darkest valleys, for the ways you lead us to still meadows for the ways you provide all we need. Hear our cry of thanksgiving. For transforming death and resurrection life, for blessing and breaking ordinary bread, for opening our eyes to recognizing you. Hear our cry of thanksgiving. Risen Lord, hear our cry for the communities of faith gathered around this world this day to celebrate your resurrection, that we may retain memory of being together, that we may embrace unity even amongst social distancing, that we may foresee a future side by side. Hear our cry for the communities of faith who serve you in this world, that we sense purpose beyond ourselves, that we perceive the needs of creation, that we stretch ourselves to respond. Hear our cry for communities of faith, that our ways may be formed by your way, that our lives may be shaped by your life, that our love be your love. Hear us as we gather this day to pray, using words Christ our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. An offering sentence this morning comes from 1 Chronicles. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom, and you are exalted as head over all. Would you stand with me as you're comfortably able, and we'll sing together our doxology hymn. Is still disfigured by poverty or sickness or selfishness or war or greed, we pray the new creation in Jesus may appear in justice, love, and peace to the glory of your name. It's for your glory, for your kingdom, that we dedicate our offerings to you this day. In love and adoration, we pray, and all of God's people said, Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Now the scriptures for this morning from Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. The resurrection of Jesus. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. "Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And then from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43. The Gentiles received the Holy Spirit. I'm sorry, the Gentiles hear the good news. Then Peter began to speak to them. "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Now he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear. Not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." Bless the reading of the Holy Spirit of the Word. And at this time, I think the puppets.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Don't you just love Easter Sunday, especially when the sun is shining and we're going to have 75 degrees today? Oh, you look out, the flowers, there's grass growing, you get to mow, you know. I mean, it's just beautiful. It's especially a beautiful day today. And on Easter morning, of course, we are celebrating Christ's resurrection. I mean, it's just a glorious day.
I would say this is turning out to be the best Easter ever.
Well, good morning, Malachi. So, it's the best Easter ever, huh? Mm-hmm. You know what? I think I know by now. I know you just pretty well. I think I know what's going on here. Lillian made you those hot cross buns that you just absolutely love and are longing for all the time.
You are right, she did, and they were yummy.
And I'm guessing you got a basket full of goodies from the Easter Bunny as well.
Right again, you're psychic. And that basket had all my favorites in it too. Starbursts, Kit Kats, jelly beans. But although the hot cross buns and the candy and all that stuff were a fun part of Easter, they're not the reason this Easter is the best ever. First of all, Jesus is risen.
He's risen indeed.
That's right. And second of all, there's my star pupil.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. He is risen.
He
He is risen indeed. I'm so happy, can't even hold it in. Jesus loves me. Jesus was willing to suffer and die for me 2,000 years ago. He already knew me, loved me enough to die on the cross, save me from my sins. Unbelievable, remarkable, amazing. I'm so excited, I'm about to hyperventilate.
Good heavens, calm down, sport. Take a breath, take it easy. Good heavens, good grief. Miss Brenda, I think I've created a monster.
Oh, no, you haven't. You've created a very energetic, very committed Christian. Good job.
Can't wait, folks. I'm going out there and spread the word about Jesus to anyone willing to stand still long enough to listen. I'm saving some souls today. Watch out, world. Here I come. In the word of Isaiah, the sovereign Lord hath given me the well-instructed tongue to know the word to sustain the weary. Bye all. Happy Easter. I got work to do. Word to spread.
I'm not sure I'm happy about this. Homer's so pumped up. He's just ripe for a fall. I'm kind of worried. What if folks won't listen to him, or worse, what if they do listen and then they laugh at him, or they're mean to him, or they try to tell him he's wrong?
Well, if they do, Malachi, he'll be in very good company. Isaiah had to put up with people doing a lot of mean things to him. When people didn't like what he had to say, they teased him, they yelled at him, some even hit him and spit on him. Can you imagine all that?
Yuck, that's awful. Shame on them. Did he run off and hide when he did that?
No, absolutely not. Isaiah said, I have not turned away. I did not hide my face from mocking. Because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. And I know I will not be put to shame.
So Isaiah knew that God would protect him from people who said it did mean things to him, so long as he was doing God's will, right? Do you think God will watch over Homer like that too?
Oh, of course he will. God is always by our side, watching over us, protecting us, especially when we're doing what he wants us to do. And he has his ways of letting us know when we get off course and we do something that we shouldn't be doing.
Don't I know it? That's why God gave me Lillian. She's great at keeping me on the straight and narrow path, or else.
Yes, and we're all grateful for Lillian.
Well, I know. I goof up a lot more than a person should. That's why I'm so glad to have Jesus in my life now. He sacrificed so much so that an undeserving guy like me could be saved from his sins. That's so amazing and generous and loving, I can't hardly wrap my mind around it.
Well, you know what, Malachi? None of us can. It's a hard thing to grasp. God's love and compassion for us is so much greater and deeper than any of our minds can really understand. All we can do is worship and adore him and try to be as much like his son Jesus as we can. And we need to follow the Great Commission.
The Great Commission? What's that?
Well, it's what Jesus said to his disciples right before he ascended into heaven. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age.
Well, that settles that. I need to get out there and start making some disciples myself, just like Homer's doing.
I think you've been doing that, Malachi, for quite some time. Let's say a prayer, okay?
Oh, okay.
Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless us today and throughout this week. And Lord, anytime we have the opportunity to witness and tell someone about you, I pray, Lord, that we can stand up, be strong, and share your message and the wonderful gift that you have given us, your Son. In your name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ms. Brenda. Oh, and you kids, by the way, I brought a special guest with me today. Take a look. It's Easter Bunny. Yep, and he's got something special for you. You have to come up here at the end of the service, and he's going to give you a special little gift for Easter, okay? So don't forget, come on up here at the end of the service, okay? We'll see you all later. Bye-bye. Love you. Happy Easter.
You can remain seated. We'll sing together from our hymnals number 225, Worship Christ the Risen King. The words should also be on the screens. And the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Lord, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. I call today's message, Not What I Expected, because I think that's generally the theme of Easter, at least as I think of it. I know we generally say, He is risen indeed, right? He is not here, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Yeah, and I suppose it's probably good that we just stick with that, because if I were a contributing author to our denomination's manual of worship, I probably would have submitted a different liturgy. I probably would have had the response be, well, that's not what I expected. I wonder if we could try it. He is not here, He is risen.
That's not what I expected.
Yeah, right? Because if we look at the Easter story, every account of the Easter story, not just Mark's version that we read today, you will not see a single person go to the empty tomb, find it empty, and proclaim, yep, that's just what I thought was going to happen. Saw it on the horizon, called it months ago, knew it was coming. No, you don't see that anywhere in Scripture. Mark's gospel tells us that when the women discovered Jesus was not in the tomb, they were alarmed. Now, alarmed, I think, seems like too soft a word for this occasion. Alarmed. Alarmed is what you feel when you wake up to the sound of the garbage truck and realize you forgot to set your trash out the night before. That's alarmed. Alarmed is what you feel when you realize too late that there's no toilet paper in the stall. That's alarmed. I don't think alarmed adequately describes the shock and the panic and the fear and the grief these women experienced at the tomb on that Easter morning. So maybe I will send in that liturgy submission for our next manual of worship. He is not here, He is risen. That's not what I expected. Truthfully, if there were one overarching theme for all of Easter, that would be it. Not what I expected. Have you ever had something go very differently than what you expected? one of my favorite stories on this topic, and I know a couple of you have heard this before, comes from my college years. I started my undergrad at SIUE over in Edwardsville. It's been a while now. That's occurred to me. This year is my high school class's 20-year reunion. And you know, the hardest part about that for me is I can vividly remember with absolute clarity how old and out of date I thought my parents were when they celebrated their 20-year reunion. I was about the same age then that my daughter is now. Thankfully, my daughter thinks her parents are young and hip and trendy. Don't you, sweetie? So 20 years ago this fall, I started college, and SIUE is not a small school. Enrollment in those days was around 10,000 students. Lots of buildings, lots of places to get turned around and lost, lots of food court options in the cafeteria, too. And I'll never forget seeing for the first time the burrito shrine. That's what I call it in my memory. The build-your-own burrito counter in the cafeteria. I'd never seen anything like it. You know, some people remember with clarity the first time they laid eyes on the person who would later be their spouse. Some people can recall the first time they saw a sunrise. Some people remember the first time they looked into the eyes of their own child. I'll never forget the sight of all of those toppings that could go inside a burrito. It's hard to describe the liberating feeling of joy of knowing you can put as much stuff in the burrito as you want. You're only limited by the structural integrity of the burrito itself. And thankfully, one of my best friends was an engineering major, so he had an idea of what the structural integrity of the burrito was. As I recall, I went with a ground beef, refried bean combo for starters. That was the beginning, and then lettuce and sour cream and some cheese and olives. And you know, then just because I could, I added some grilled steak and cubed chicken. Because, like they say at the post office, if it fits, it ships, right? I had this massive burrito, the size of an NFL football, not the deflated ones that Tom Brady threw in New England, the real NFL football. The thing probably weighed about 3 pounds, and that's where the story goes sour, right? Because when I got to the cash register to pay for lunch, there I was alarmed. There's that word again. Alarmed to discover that you had to put your plate on a scale by the cash register because the weight of the plate is how they determine the price of your lunch. Do you know how much a 3-pound burrito costs? $12. And that was 20 years ago. U.S. Consumer Pricing Index calculates cumulative rate of inflation over the last two decades has been about 47%. So if it seems like a lot of things have doubled in price in the last 20 years, that's because they have. So in today's money, adjusting for inflation, that burrito would cost about $18. Not what I expected. At this time last year, the general feeling was if we all just stayed home for about 2 weeks, this new virus would be quickly contained. How many times in the last year have we said, this is not what I expected? And I think this is a very essential part of the Easter story. We humans, we have a tendency to paint a picture in our imagination of how we think things will go or how things ought to go. We draw from previous experiences and we mix in a little bit of anticipation and hope. And we paint this picture in our minds, and sometimes it's a very detailed picture of how we think things are going to turn out, how tomorrow will look, and then the day after that. And sometimes, actually a lot of the time, I think we get it pretty right. I think we're pretty good because, you know, the more common things are, the more consistent things are, the more we know what to expect. But sometimes things just don't go the way we think they should, and that's the Easter story. Jesus rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday to an excited and an animated crowd, not because they knew he was the Son of God, not because they knew he would be the connection between us and God, but because they thought he would be a king, because they thought he would take the throne that was once held by King David, that he would reunite a fractured Hebrew nation, a king to overthrow the Roman occupying military, a king to restore order and peace to all of the Hebrew people. And I wonder how many of the Hebrew people saw the events of Holy Week as they unfolded, the arrest and the trial and the crucifixion, and said to themselves, "This is not what I expected." I wonder how many of Jesus' own disciples who had learned and lived alongside their master for years, who had come to believe that he was indeed the Son of God, I wonder how many of them saw the humiliation and death of their Lord and said to themselves, "This is not what I expected." This dates all the way back to Jesus' birth. The world was looking for a savior to make a majestic entry into creation. Instead, we got a baby born in an animal trough to unwed parents, to a teen mother and her carpenter fiance. And I wonder how many people from the very beginning of Jesus' life said, "This is not what I expected." And as I said, on that Easter morning when the burial tomb was discovered to be empty, I bet if you asked anyone who saw it with their own eyes, they would all tell you, "This is not what I expected." And I believe there are a lot of people in the world today who used to be in the church, but then Jesus, or maybe even the church itself, turned out to be not what they expected. You see, throughout his whole life and ministry, Jesus didn't turn out to be what people expected. Jesus didn't function like a military leader or ruler. He lived as a servant. That was unexpected. He did not bring judgment or condemnation to his enemies. In fact, while hanging on the cross, he said of his executioners, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." His ministry was marked by grace and compassion and forgiveness, and that was unexpected. He did not antagonize his opponents. He did not strong-arm people into following or seeing things from his point of view. He went from village to village showing compassion and love to people who particularly did not deserve it. That was unexpected. He seemed especially drawn to the meek and the powerless, the sick and the outcast. The least of these is what he calls them. People the rest of us would rather not give our time or attention to. That was unexpected. I think it's very safe to say Jesus of Nazareth, this peasant carpenter from Galilee, was not what anyone had in mind. And I wish I could tell you that that was all in the past, but I believe there are people today who still feel let down by a Jesus who just doesn't live up to their expectations. People who have painted that picture in their mind of what they expect when they think of Jesus and what Jesus would do for their own lives. Throughout history, we've heard that when people are suffering, Jesus will give them comfort. We tell people who are lonely or lost that Jesus will give you peace. We tell ourselves that Jesus will do so many great things in our own lives. Maybe we even imagine in our minds a Jesus who will avenge us to all of the people who have wronged us. And I do believe there are thousands of empty church pews all over the world that used to be full of people who believed in Jesus, but then he didn't live up to their expectations, and so they went home. I believe there are millions of people who used to be on fire for Christ, but you know, their families, they still fought. Their finances still struggled. They still struggled to make ends meet. Their health didn't improve, or their loved ones didn't survive. They still had horrifyingly difficult decisions to make in life. They still experienced grief or sadness. They still experienced stress or injustice. And they began to say to themselves, "This Jesus is just not what I expected." I've heard it said before, did Jesus fail to come when you rubbed a lantern? Maybe Jesus is not a genie. Did Jesus fail to punish your enemies? Maybe Jesus is not your judge. Did Jesus fail to make things run smoothly in your life? Maybe Jesus is not a mechanic. Over and over again, people find disappointment that Jesus doesn't turn out to be what they think he should be. And over again, God reminds us that God's the one who writes Jesus' job description, not us. It is alarming. There's that word again. It's alarming how many people decide what they need Jesus to be in their lives instead of allowing themselves to become what Jesus needs us to be. Maybe you found yourself doing this before. Maybe we've all, from time to time, told Jesus what we need him to be for us, rather than allowing ourselves to become what he needs us to be for him. To allow him to challenge us. To allow him to inspire us. To allow him to correct and realign and guide us. To allow him to comfort us. To allow him to control us. Because that's what it means to call Jesus Lord. It means to let him have control over us. I do believe a lot of people experience the authentic Jesus and say, this is not what I expected. I thought my life would be sunshine and roses. I thought I would have no more trials or troubles. I think that says a lot more about our own expectations than it does our Lord and Savior. Jesus did not come to right all of our wrongs. Jesus did not come to cure everything that ails us. Jesus did not come to stop all of our wars or fix our politics. Jesus did not come to make our lives easy or uneventful. Jesus came to reconcile us with God, to make abundantly clear to us that no matter what we experience in life, we experience it with God at our side, as our companion, to give us the promise and the hope that God is indeed with us, to inspire us, each one of us, to inspire us to do whatever we possibly can to ease the pain of those who are suffering, to improve the lives of those around us. Jesus calls us to be a source of compassion and hope as he is to us. Jesus teaches us to work for peace and to ease the burdens of others, and Jesus commands us to love others as he himself loves us. Maybe the most unexpected part of the whole Easter story is how it changes us, how it softens us, how it inspires us, how it comforts us and guides us and encourages us and reminds us that in Jesus, the distance between God and us has been eliminated. He is not here, he is risen. And yeah, that's pretty unexpected. And because he is risen, we now have a future secured and a path laid out before us. We now know what to expect in life. In faith, even death cannot separate us from the love God has for us. Now it's time for us to carry on that divine work of compassion and hospitality and selflessness and servant-like work that the world so desperately needs. And maybe if we do it right, maybe if we really do give control over to God, maybe if we really do serve God as Jesus teaches us to, then maybe the world will look at us in joy and smile and say, that is not what we expected. It's our time to be the church that nobody expected. Amen?
Amen.
Will you pray with me? Lord, it's a humbling reality to recognize how little we understand and yet how much it impacts our faith. It's a humbling reality to not be able to articulate exactly the details, the mechanics of how the resurrection worked, but yet to know that it is the event that brings you and us together unlike anything else in the world. And it's a humbling reality to recognize that you call us to live as resurrection people, people who know that not even death can separate us from you. You teach us to proclaim your love, to do your good works, to carry on the mission and the ministry of Jesus in our lives. Lord, I pray that you inspire and equip us to be people, to be a church that no one expected. I pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
If you would stand with me as you're comfortably able to sing together hymn number 226, The Day of Resurrection. We'll sing verses 1 and 3.
Thank you.
be seated. If you didn't get a communion cup on your way in and you'd like one still, raise your hand and Brenda in the back can make sure that everybody's got one, but it looks like we're all good. We'll need this in just a moment. I'll let you know when to open it, but not yet. First, we hear a proclamation. The gospel tells us that as the risen Christ sat at table with two of his followers, he was made known to them in the breaking of bread. Almost immediately after the resurrection, Jesus began appearing to his disciples. And one of those appearances occurred with two disciples on the road to Emmaus. At this table, we invite all who believe in him and who are in fellowship with one another to partake of this, the Lord's Supper. Let us give thanks to God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing to proclaim your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Gracious God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we lift our hearts, we offer our thanks for the works and the words that you have given us, for humankind and the richness of love, for each new day of forgiveness and grace. With thanksgiving, we remember the one who was with you from the beginning, through whom all things were made, whose life is the light of the world, and who became flesh and lived among us as Jesus the Messiah. For his life and ministry, for his teaching and example, and for his love, we give you thanks. For his victory on the cross, we thank you, O God. For the hope that comes through his resurrection, we thank you. For the promise that in him all things will be made new, we thank you, Lord. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread. After giving thanks, he shared it among his friends and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup. After giving thanks, he passed it among his friends and explained, "This cup is a symbol. This is my blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this also in remembrance of me." For however often you take this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. This is the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Will you pray with me? Grant, O God, that your Holy Spirit may be with us, and that through the bread and cup we hold in our hands, may Christ come again to dwell among us, and through him may we again come to know you, whom to know is life eternal. Amen. Now, the trick to opening these: the top layer is clear, and that's the hard one. If you get the top layer open, that's how you get your wafer. And then the second layer is a purple layer. That reveals your juice. So take a moment and go ahead and open your communion cups. And if you would, just hold your wafer when that way I can see how we're doing. Christ, our Paschal Lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. The body of life, the bread of heaven. The cup of Christ, the cup of salvation. If you would join me, we'll join together in a prayer of dedication. The words are on the screen. Let's pray this together. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world.
Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, grant us your peace. Most merciful God, take our hands, which have held that which is consecrated, and work through them. Take our lips, which have tasted the signs of the body and blood of our Lord, and speak through them. Take our bodies, which have received the bread and wine, and make them fit temples of your Spirit. Take our minds and mold them, that our thoughts may be your thoughts. Take our hearts and fill them with your love, that we may truly serve you in the world. Amen.
It's the custom in this congregation after communion to stand and join together in the first verse of Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. Let's stand and sing. Probably haven't forgotten, but kids, there is a special treat up front. Remember, Malachi said to come forward at the end of the service. For everyone else, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Not what I expected.
Receive this blessing. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Your hair looks so pretty.